Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to CEC Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in this session, we are going to talk on proteins in detail. We would be specifically covering on the structure and classification of proteins. And for this discussion, we have once again with us in our studios, Dr. Sushila Singhal. Dr. Sushila Singhal is Assistant Professor in Department of Chemistry, Deshbandhu College, University of Delhi. Friends, if you want to ask any question from Dr. Sushila Singhal on the particular topic, that is proteins, then you can call right in the studio. You can contact us through our toll-free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. So friends, you are requested to call in the last 10 minutes so that the lecture goes uninterrupted and your queries are also resolved. So please do call us between 4:05 to 4:15. Now, let's welcome our guest, Dr. Sushila Singhal, once again, and let's try to have a vivacious session on proteins. Hello, ma'am. Welcome to the EduSet
lecture. Thank you, Ritika ji. Good day, viewers. After discussing the three lectures on the amino acid, today we are discussing about the protein, which is the main nutrient in our diet. This protein, which is the polymer of the amino acids, first we have to discuss its introduction, its composition, that which elements are present in this protein molecule. Then we will discuss the classification of this protein, which is based upon many criteria. One of them is the source of the protein molecule. Then will come the classification based upon the composition, which will include the simple proteins, conjugated proteins, and the derived proteins. Further, we will classify the proteins on the basis of the functions in the body, that how these protein molecules do the various metabolic reactions. In this classification, we will include the enzymes, structural proteins, contractile proteins, storage proteins, defense proteins, toxic proteins, hormones, and the blood proteins. And in the second module, we will discuss about the structure of protein, that how the three-dimensional structure of protein has been grouped into different categories. And in these categories, we will discuss about the primary structure of proteins, secondary structure, which will further include the alpha helix and beta plated sheets. Then we will discuss about the further coiling of the secondary structure, resulting in the formation of tertiary structure. And after that, we will discuss about the quaternary structure. So, starting with the protein molecules, the name of this protein, which is derived from the word protease, it means the preeminent or the first compound which is of prime importance. And this protein name of this protein was suggested by a Swedish chemist, J.J. Berzelius, in 1838. His comment about the proteins is read as follows, as he has quoted, that there is present in plants and animals a substance which is without doubt the most important of the known substances in living matter, and without it life would be impossible on our planet. This material has been named protein. The name is well chosen because the protein are the basis of protoplasm and all which is present in all the living organisms. This protein, it occupies a very central position in the architecture and functioning of the living matter. They are intimately connected with the all phases of the chemical and the physical activity that constitute the life of a cell. Proteins are mainly present in the all tissues like muscles, skin, hair, and other tissues that make up the bulk of the body, known bony structure. As enzyme, they catalyzes the many biochemical reactions. As hormones, they regulate many metabolic processes. And as antibiotics, antibodies, they resist and they nullify the effect of the toxic substances which is present inside the body. In fact, these proteins have built into their structures the information that instructs them in what to do in the catalytic activity and where to go in the cell, that is the intracellular organization, and when and how to perform, which is the control of the function through the bacterial interaction with other proteins or the small activators or the inhibitor. All these activities are performed by only protein molecules. The plants, they synthesize this protein from the carbon dioxide from the environment, from the water molecules from the environment, and the nitrates, sulfates and phosphates which are present inside the soil. These are the fertilizers. So plants synthesize the proteins from the environment as well as from the soil. Now all protein, they contain the elements carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen as well as the sulfur. They may contain some other elements like phosphorus also, and are traces of other elements like iron, copper, iodine, manganese and zinc in the conjugated form. Proteins have very high molecular weight structures. The molecular weight may range from 10,000 to over 50 million molecular weight. All proteins, they yield amino acids upon complete hydrolysis. Since these are the polymers of the amino acids, thus we can define the proteins as a high molecular weight organic materials which upon complete hydrolysis yields the amino acids. Then comes the classification of proteins. Proteins can be classified according to their source, according to their structure, solubility behavior, or according to their known protein moiety. So starting with the first classification, which is based upon the source of the protein molecules, the proteins can be divided into the two categories. One is the animal protein and other one is the plant protein. Animal protein are the proteins which are derived from the animal sources such as eggs, milk, meat and fish. And these are usually called the higher quality proteins because they contain adequate amount of all the essential amino acid which should be present in a balanced protein diet. And the second category is the plant proteins. The plant proteins are the proteins which are derived from the plant sources. They are usually called the lower quality proteins because they contain only the limiting amount of one or the more of the essential amino acid. It means some essential amino acid may not be present in the plant sources. So it is good to take the animal proteins rather than the plant proteins. Then comes the classification which is based upon the solubility and the shape of the protein molecules. And based upon this classification, the proteins has been classified further into two categories. The one is the fibrous protein and the other one is the globular proteins. Now first we will discuss about the fibrous proteins. Since the name itself suggests that they are the fiber-like structures, it means they are the long thread-like structures and they tend to lie side by side to form the fibers. These are very tough and usually insoluble in water and aqueous solutions of acid and bases and also in some organic solvents. The long linear protein chains are held together by the intermolecular hydrogen bonds. Since hydrogen bond is present, these are very tough and very strong proteins. These are highly resistant to the digestion by the proteolytic enzymes. The fibrous proteins are extremely strong and these possesses the two important properties which are characteristics of the elastomers also. So these are, since we are saying the elastomers, so they can be stretched and later recoil to their original length. And the second property is that they can have a tendency to creep. It means that is if stretched for a long time, their basic length increases and equals the stretched length. But if the tension of the two ends of the fibril is relaxed, they creep to their shorter and shorter length. The most fibrous protein, they serves in the structural or the protective role in the human body. These fibrous proteins are heterogeneous and they include the proteins of silk, wool, skin, hair, nails, blood vessels and connective tissues and bones also. Now we will discuss about few examples of fibrous proteins which will include the keratins, collagens, elastins and fibrions. So first of all we will discuss about the keratin. The alpha keratin are found in the outer layers of the skin which is the ectodermal layer and these are the major constituent of the epithelial tissues which is a skin in hair and in the wool. They consist of alpha helixes that are twisted together like the strands of a rope. Beta keratin are found in hard tissues such as nails, horns, hooves and the bird feathers. They have a beta pleated sheet structure which is a type of secondary structure of protein. Then comes the collagens. Collagen proteins are found in the white fibrous connective tissues which constitutes the tendons. Tendons are the tissues which connects the muscles to the bones. These are also the main components of the bone, teeth and the cartilage. More than half of the total protein in the mammalian body is the collagen. The third category of fibrous protein is elastin. They are found in the yellow elastic tissues like ligaments and blood vessels. Then comes the fibrin. This protein is present in silk fibers and composed mainly of glycine, alanine and serine units of amino acids. Then the second category of this classification is the globular proteins. These globular proteins are soluble in water and in dilute acid, alkalis and salts. These solutions are colloidal in nature due to the large size of the protein molecules. These are highly branched structures and cross-link condensation products of basic and acidic amino acids. These are more complex in conformation than the fibrous proteins. The globular proteins, they serve a variety of functions which are related to the maintenance and regulation of the life processes. They do all such functions that require mobility and hence the solubility. If a particular protein is soluble, then only it will move inside the body. They usually function as the enzymes, antibodies, hormones and the transport proteins. Example of transport protein is the hemoglobin, which is the oxygen carrying proteins. Examples of these globular proteins are insulin, hemoglobin, enzyme ribonuclease and fibrinogen, which is converted into the insoluble fibrous protein fibrin, and thus it causes the clotting of the blood. So in the body, the globular proteins, first, which is a soluble protein, it may convert into the insoluble fibrous protein via some metabolic reactions. So the interconversion can be possible. The third category of classification is based upon the composition. According to this classification system, proteins has been divided into three categories: simple proteins, conjugated proteins, and the derived proteins. Now, simple proteins are those proteins which yield only alpha amino acids upon hydrolysis. They do not contain any known protein part attached to them. Most of these proteins are globular in nature, and these are further subdivided according to their solubility in various solvents and also whether they are coagulated by heat, whether coagulation takes place or not. So, depending upon these two properties, these are further classified into various subcategories. One of them is the albumin. These proteins are found in plants mainly. These are found in plants mainly in the seeds and in the animals also. These are soluble in water and the aqueous solutions of acid, bases, and salts. And these are usually low or deficient in the glycine amino acid. These can be precipitated by saturating the solution either with a neutral salt such as the sodium sulfate in slightly acidic solution or with the acidic salt such as the ammonium sulfate. These albumin upon heating, they also get coagulated. An example of these albumin proteins are the blood serum albumin, soybean albumin, gliadin, which is a wheat albumin, lactalbumin. Lactalbumin is the protein which is present in the milk, that is a casein, leguminin, which is the protein present in the pulses, egg white, and the oval, which is also called as oval albumin. Then the second category is the globulins. These are present both in the animal and the plant tissues. These are further insoluble in water but readily dissolves in dilute neutral salts such as sodium chloride. These can be precipitated by the half saturation with the ammonium sulfate. These proteins also coagulate on heating, and examples of the globulins are oval globulin, lactoglobulin, serum globulin in blood plasma, and myosin in muscles are also the animal globulin. Vegetable globulin are mainly present in the legumin, tuberins, and in the wheat and the hemp seeds. Then the third category is the glutulins. These are isolated exclusively from the plant seeds. These can be easily coagulated by heat, also insoluble in water, alcohols, and the neutral salt solutions. And these are comparatively rich in the arginine, proline, and the glutamic acid. amino acids. An example of this category is the glutenin from the wheat, glutenin from the corn, and the arginine from the rice. The next category is the prolamines. These are isolated only from the plant seeds. These are insoluble in water, alcohol, and the dilute salt solutions, but are soluble in the dilute acid and alkalis, and also in 60 to 80% alcohol solutions. These prolamines can be easily coagulated by heat, and they contain a large amount of proline, but they are deficient in lysine amino acid. Example of this class are the xanthine from the maize, gliadin from the wheat, and the hordein from the barley. The next class of these simple proteins is the albuminoids, which are also called as saccharoproteins. These occur almost entirely in the animals and are therefore commonly known as the animal skeleton proteins. These are insoluble in all neutral solvents and in dilute acids and the alkalis. These are the protective of the these are the proteins of the supportive tissues, and examples of these are keratin in hair, collagen of bones, elastin in ligaments, horny tissues, and the fibrin from the silk. Now, these albuminoids or the saccharoproteins can be further divided into the two categories. One of them is the collagen, which is found in the skin, tendon, and the bones. When collagens are boiled with water, gelatin, a water-soluble protein is obtained. And these collagens, they appear to be unique in their high content of hydroxyprolines and in containing the hydroxylysins. These are attacked by the pepsin and the trypsin. The second category is the elastin. These are present in tendons, arteries, and the other elastic tissues. Although these are similar to collagens in many respects, but they cannot be converted into the gelatins and are attacked by the enzymes. And one of the enzymes is the trypsin, which act on the elastin proteins. Then the next category is the basic proteins, which further includes the two groups. One of them is the histone. These histones are the basic proteins which are insoluble in water or dilute acids, but these are insoluble in the dilute ammonia. These are further not coagulated by the heat, and these are rich in the basic amino acids, which includes the histidine and the arginine, but these are deficient in the tryptophan, and they contain a little cysteine and the methionine amino acids also, which are having the sulfur contents. These histones are readily hydrolyzed by the enzymes. It can be extracted in the large amount from the certain glandular tissues such as the thymus and the pancreas. And the most histones are combined with the nucleic acid and the transport proteins. The next category of basic proteins is the protamines. Protamines occurs almost entirely in the animals and are the main components of the sperm cells of certain fishes. These principally found in the egg cells. These are more basic than histones, and these are the simplest of all naturally occurring proteins and having the lowest molecular weights. These are further soluble in water and in the ammonium hydroxide also, and are further not coagulated by the heat. These protamines are virtually devoid of the sulfur and the aromatic amino acid. It means cysteine and the methionine may not be present in this category, but they have a high nitrogen content, approximate 20 to 30%, due to the presence of the large quantity of the arginine. These protamines are hydrolyzed by the enzymes, mainly by the trypsin and pepsin, but not by the pepsin enzyme. Then comes the second category. Other than the simple protein is the conjugated proteins. Conjugated proteins are the proteins which, along with the main part of the protein amino acid, they also have some known protein substance, and this known protein substance in conjugated proteins is termed as the prosthetic group. This group may be separated from the protein part by carrying out the hydrolysis very carefully. Now, depending upon the nature of this prosthetic group, the conjugated proteins can be divided into various classes. Few of them is the glycoproteins, nucleoproteins, metalloproteins, chromoproteins, and a few more. First, we'll discuss about the glycoprotein. Since the name itself suggests that it contains the glyco, it means glyco is a form of a glucose, or the glyco content, which is a example of carbohydrates. So here the prosthetic group is carbohydrate. And these are also called as mucoproteins. They contains comparatively higher amount of carbohydrates that is more than 4%. These upon hydrolysis yields amino sugar. It means they are upon hydrolysis yielding the amino acid as well as the sugar. Example of this glycoproteins are the mucin of saliva, heparin of bile juices, immunoglobulins of plasma, and mucopolysaccharides of cartilage and tendons. Then comes the next category of this conjugated proteins, which is a nucleoprotein. Since the name itself suggests here also that it is the nucleoprotein, so the prosthetic group here will be the nucleic acid. These proteins are the protamines and the histones, and these are usually the salt-like compounds of the protein, since the two components have opposite charges and these are bound together by the electrostatic forces. And these are present in the nuclear substances also, in the case of DNA and RNAs, and as well as in the cytoplasm. These may be considered as the sites for the synthesis of proteins and the enzymes, since in the DNA and RNA protein synthesis takes place. And examples of this class of nucleoproteins are from the yeast and the thymus, and also from the viruses, which are regarded as the large molecules of nucleoproteins. Nucleohistones from the nuclei rich materials like glandular tissues, which is the nuclein. Then the next category of this conjugated protein is the lipoprotein. The name itself suggests lipoprotein. It means the prosthetic group here will be the lipids. Lipids may include the cephalins, lecithin, cholesterols, etc. These are soluble in water, but these are insoluble in organic solvents. An example of lipoproteins are lipovitellin and the lipovitellin from the egg yolk, and the lipoproteins of blood, which is namely VHDL, very high density lipids, high density lipids, low density lipids, and the very low density lipids, based on the density gradient separation. So based on the density gradient separation, we can classify these lipoproteins into various categories into the blood. Then the next class is the phosphoproteins. Phosphoproteins contains the prosthetic group phosphoric acid. These are soluble in dilute alkalis and are precipitated by the addition of acids. Example of this class is the casein, the milk protein, and the ovovitellin of the eggs. Then the next category of conjugated protein is the flavoproteins. Here the known prosthetic group is the flavones, which is attached to the protein moiety. Flavoproteins are basically the enzymes of the Krebs cycle and are precipitate in the electron transport system of the respiratory chain. Then the next class of this conjugated protein is the chromoprotein. Here the since chromo means the colored pigments, so here the known prosthetic group will be the colored pigments like flavins, carotenoids, and the porphyrin rings, etc. Example of chromoproteins are myoglobin, hemoglobin, hemocyanin, hemoerythrin, which are present in the bile juice of the liver, cytochrome, flavoproteins, and catalase enzymes, etc. Similarly, the chlorophyll, which is present in the leaf cell in the form of a protein, is the chloroplastin. The chloroplastin dissolves in water as a colloid and is readily denatured. The next class of conjugated protein is the metalloprotein. Here the known prosthetic group is the, here the prosthetic group is the metal. Metal can be iron, it can be zinc, it can be copper, it can be manganese. Example of these metalloproteins are the hemoglobin and chlorophyll. Siderophyllin, an important plasma protein, it has a very great affinity for the iron. These proteins may be of stable nature and may be more or less labile. Now, based on their reactivity with the metal ions, these metalloproteins, they may be classified into the three categories. One of them is the metals, which are strongly bound by the proteins. Few heavy metals like mercury, silver, copper, and zinc, they become strongly binded with the proteins like collagen, albumin, and the casein through the SH radical of the side chains. So these are very strongly bounded to the proteins. The next category is the metals which are weakly bounded by the proteins. Calcium belongs to this category. In these conjugation, binding takes place with the help of radicals possessing the electric charge. And the third category includes those metals which do not couple with the protein. And in this category, sodium and potassium comes. These forms the compounds in the nucleic acid, which apparently electrostatic bonds are present. So this was all about the conjugated proteins. Now, based upon the composition and the shape, the third category is the derived proteins. The derived proteins are those proteins which are obtained by the degradation of the protein moiety of the polypeptide chains. So, which is a result of the action of heat, which may be a result of enzymatic hydrolysis or by some chemical reagents. So, depending upon the degradation products, these are further divided into two categories. One is a primary derived protein and one is a secondary derived proteins. In case of primary derived proteins, in which the size of the protein molecule is not altered very materially, it means the size of protein will be remain fixed. In this class, the proteins, metaproteins are included. Proteins are insoluble in water and they appear as the first product produced by the action of acids, enzymes or waters or own proteins. Examples are adenosine derived from adenosine and the myosin derived from the myosin. Then comes the metaproteins. These are the proteins which are obtained by the hydrolysis of the complex proteins by the action of the digestive enzymes, acids and the alkalis. The initial products formed are the proteoses, which are insoluble in water and can be salted out by the half saturation with the ammonium sulfates. Example of metaproteins are the acid and the alkali proteins. Then comes the coagulated proteins. These are the coagulated or the denatured proteins obtained when ordinary proteins are heated. When the proteins are heated, they get coagulated and their nature get disturbed. So, they become the denatured products. Proteins, so they comes under this category. In these proteins, the molecular mass doesn't change, only the property changes which get denatured. So the properties like solubility, its precipitation, they get disturbed, they get altered. And examples of these coagulated proteins are the egg white. Then comes the second category of this class is the secondary derived proteins, and these are the derivatives of proteins in which the hydrolysis has occurred, certainly resulting in the smaller protein than the original one. It means that the first the proteins are hydrolyzed into the polypeptide chains, then these polypeptide chains upon hydrolysis will further convert into the smaller polypeptide chain and which will further hydrolyzed into the amino acids. So in these categories, the proteoses are the proteins, these which are soluble in water and are coagulated by the heat. These are produced when hydrolysis proceeds beyond the level of metaproteins. These primary proteoses are salted out by the half saturation with the ammonium sulfate and are precipitated by the nitric acid and the picric acid. While the secondary proteoses are the salted out only by the complete saturation with the ammonium sulfate, but these are not precipitated by the nitric acid and the picric acid. An example of these proteoses are the albuminose from albumin and the globulose from the globulin. Then the second category of this secondary derived proteins are the peptones. These are soluble in water, but these are not coagulated by the heat. These are produced by the action of dilute acids or enzymes when hydrolysis proceeds beyond proteoses. These are neither salted by the ammonium sulfate and nor precipitated by the nitric acid and the picric acid. And the last class of classification is the polypeptide. These are combinations of two or more amino acid units. In fact, the proteins are the essentially long chain peptides. So this was all about the classification of the proteins, that how we have classified the proteins on the basis of its source, on the basis of its composition, in which we have studied the simple proteins, the conjugated proteins, and in the third category we have done the classification which is based upon its hydrolysis products, that whether the proteins upon hydrolysis they converts only into the alpha amino acid or some prosthetic groups are present here or not. Thank you. The other one. Welcome back. Now there comes the third classification, which is based upon the biological functions that the structural and the chemical and based upon the physical and the chemical structure and the location inside the cell of a protein that these will perform which type of functions. These are further classified into many categories. One of them is the enzymes. Enzymes are the proteins which are the globular proteins. When these are present in the human body, they perform some highly specialized work which are the catalytic properties, and these are all the chemical reactions of the organic biomolecules which are catalyzed by the enzymes. Chemically, some enzymes are simple proteins containing only the amino acid residues. These enzymes may be complex proteins containing some major protein part, which is the apoprotein, and they may contain small non-protein part, which is the prosthetic group associated with the protein unit. Urease, amylase, catalase, cytochrome C, alcohol, dehydrogenase are the examples of this class of enzyme category. Then comes the structural proteins. Since the name itself suggests the structural proteins, it means they are the main constituent of the framework of the body. So the structural proteins are very inert to the biochemical reactions. They maintain the native form and the position of the organs. The cell wall and the primary fibrous constituent of the cells have the structural proteins. The collagen, which has very high tensile strength, is the most abundant protein of animals. It is found in connective tissues such as tendons, cartilage, matrix of bones and the cornea of the eye. Leather is almost the pure collagen. So, leather is a structural protein which is present in the animals. Ligament, they contains the elastin, a structural protein which is capable of stretching in the in two dimensions. Alpha keratin constitutes almost the entire dry weight of the hair, wool, feather, nails, claws, horns and the tortoise shell and most of the outer layer of the skin. It means alpha keratin is ectodermal in nature. The major component of silk fibers and the spider web is the fibrion, which is a fibrous protein. The wing hinges of some insects are also protein, which are made up of resilin, which has nearly the perfect elastic properties. Then comes the third category, which is a transport protein, or it may also called as the carrier proteins. These transport proteins, they are present specially in the animals and are involved in the transport of many essential biological factors to the various parts of the organism. The hemoglobin is a very good example of this transport protein, which is present in the erythrocytes of blood. It binds oxygen as the blood passes through the lungs, and it carries it to the peripheral tissues, and there it releases it to participate in the oxidation of nutrients. So hemoglobin, it carries the oxygen from the blood and it transport the oxygen to all over the whole part of the human body. The blood plasma, it contains the lipoproteins also, which carry the lipids from the liver to the other organs. Other kind of transport proteins which are present in the plasma membranes and intracellular membranes of the all organisms are also present there. Celluloplasmin, it transports copper in blood. So for the transportation of many minerals, for the transportation of oxygen and the many nutrients also, like lipids, like carbohydrate, to the various organs of our body, we can use these transport proteins in this class. Then comes the third category, which is a contractile protein, or it is also called as motile proteins. These proteins, these induce the cells in the organism with the ability to contract to change the shape or to move about. Actin and the myosin, they function in the contractile system of the skeletal muscles and also in many known muscle systems. Since actin and myosin, they are present along with the myosin, so they are free to move. So these are used in the motile proteins. Tubulin is also a protein from which the microtubules are built. The next category of this functional protein is the storage proteins. Oval albumin is the major protein of the egg white, which is stored in the eggs. The milk protein casein, it also stores many amino acid which is present in the milk. The seeds of many plants, they also stores nutrient proteins which is required for the growth of the germinating seedlings. Ferritin, which is found in some bacteria and in plants and animal tissues, they stores the iron mineral. The next class of this functional protein is the antibodies. It is also called as a defense protein, since when an injury is made on the human body, then some proteins they get activated. These proteins are termed as the defense proteins or are also called as the antibodies. They defend organism against the invasion by the some foreign species, and they protect the human body from the injury. The antibiotic examples of these classes are immunoglobulins, are the specialized proteins made by the lymphocytes of vertebrates. They can precipitate or neutralize the invading bacteria, viruses and the foreign proteins from the another species. Fibrinogen and thrombin, although these are enzymic proteins, these are also come in the antibodies class. These are the blood clotting proteins. They prevent the loss of blood when the vascular system is injured. The next class of this category is the toxic proteins. Some proteins act as the toxic substances, such as the snake venom, bacterial toxins, and the toxic plant proteins like ricin. These toxic plant proteins are also have defensive functions. When when these animals or these plant which contains the toxic element, they are also get injured, then only these proteins are released. Otherwise, these proteins stay in the some unstable states. The next category of this class comes is the hormones, which are also called as regulatory proteins. They regulate the cellular and the physiological activity of the human body. Among them, these are the hormones such as insulin, which regulates the sugar metabolism, and the growth hormones, which is required for the bone growth. The cellular response to many hormonal signals is often mediated by the class of GTP binding proteins called as the G proteins. The other regulatory proteins, they bind to DNA and they regulate the biosynthesis of enzymes and the RNA molecules in the cell divisions. So these hormones, they regulate the catabolic and metabolic activities of the human body. Then the last category is the blood proteins. The three major proteins constituent of blood, which is the albumin, hemoglobin and the fibrinogen. These are the blood proteins. Their presence contributes to the maintenance of osmotic pressure, oxygen transport and the blood coagulation respectively. So these are the classification which is based upon the function of proteins, that how they regulates the metabolic and the catabolic activity of the human body. Then after this, the next topic is the structure of protein, that how the three-dimensional structure of protein has been classified into various categories. Now, based upon the degree of complexity of protein molecules in the molecular biology, protein structure describes the various levels of organization. They have definite three-dimensional structure. The shape of protein molecule can be determined by various factors, and in the 3D, three-dimensional structures, the levels are the primary, secondary, tertiary and the quaternary structure of the protein. Now, each succeeding level of organization is more complex than the previous one and is a direct result of the chemical features of the previous levels. It means the secondary structure is more complex than the primary structure and is the coiling of the primary structure, and further the tertiary structure is a coiling and the globalization globularity of the secondary structure, and the further on. Now first we will discuss about the primary structure of the protein. In the primary structure, the special arrangement of the polypeptide chain in the protein molecule is determined by the primary structure. The primary structure of protein, it refers to the linear sequence of amino acids in its polypeptide chain and the location of the disulfide bridges, if any methionine or cysteine type of amino acids are present, then only these disulfide bridges or linkages will be present in the primary structure. It also refers to the number, the nature and the sequence of the alpha amino acid in a polypeptide. The main mode of linkage of all the amino acid in proteins is the peptide bond, which links the alpha carboxyl group of the first amino acid residue to the alpha amino group of the other ones. It means the in the polypeptide chain, in the primary sequence, the all amino acids, they are linked together via the peptide bond. The first amino acid will make the peptide bond with the second amino acid, and so on. It will make the dipeptide. Then the third amino acid will come again, make the peptide bond, and the tripeptide will be formed. Like this, if the chain comes to the amino acid 2 to 9, then it will come under the category of oligopeptides. And if the number of amino acid further increases beyond 9 amino acid, then they will come under the category of polypeptides. So in the primary structure, we will only discuss the linear arrangement of these amino acids via the peptide linkages. Then comes the secondary. Here we have shown you the primary structure of the protein. Here you can see that these are linearly arranged. This is the first amino acid, this is the amino group of the first amino acid, this is the middle carbon which is having the side chain which is the R1, and this is the first CONH bond which is a peptide bond. Then the second amino acid will come and it is further attached to the third amino acid via this second peptide bond. So with the linkage of these peptide bonds, they will make a sequence of amino acid which is termed as a primary structure, the primary sequence of the amino acids. In the primary structure, the alpha carbon of the adjacent amino acids are separated by the three covalent bonds which are arranged as the C alpha. This is the C alpha, then CN, and then again the NC alpha. This carbon is the alpha 1 and this is the alpha 1. So these three bonds are arranged repeatedly and will make the sequence of the amino acid. In addition, this CN bond in the peptide is somewhat shorter than the CN bond which is present in the simple amines, because these are attached to the carbonyl compound also. Here the CO group is also present. So the atoms associated with the this bond get shorter due to the resonance present between this bond, and the atoms associated with these bonds are the coplanar in nature. It indicates the resonance and the partial sharing of the two pairs of electrons between the carboxyl oxygen and the amide nitrogen, which is a NH linkage. The oxygen has a partial negative charge and the nitrogen has a partial positive charge, which set up a sort of electric dipole in the primary structure. The four atoms of the peptide bond, which is the carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen, they lie in a single plane, so they are coplanar in nature. But the CO bond and the NH bond, the oxygen and the hydrogen present on the NH, they are trans to each other. Virtually the all peptide bonds in the proteins are in the trans configuration. It may be concluded that the amide CN bonds are unable to rotate freely because of this partial double bond character, because of its geometry which is in the trans configuration. Since trans configuration is there, so the rotation, free rotation is restricted in this primary structure. The backbone of polypeptide chain can thus be separated by substituted methylene groups, which may contains a different type of R chains, different type of side groups. Here we have shown you again the primary structure of amino acid. In the previous figure, we have shown the linkage, and here we have shown you the different type of amino acids, that how they are linearly arranged to give a primary structure of a protein making the peptide bonds. And the sequence of amino acid and the protein chain is essentially random. It means that the glycine amino acid, it can be repeated many more times in a same polypeptide chain. Small variation in the sequence of these amino acids have pronounced effect on the chemical and the physical property of the protein. It means if we change the any amino acid in a particular peptide chain to the some different peptide chain, then the nature of this primary structure of protein will be different from the second category, which is having the different protein, different type of amino acids. So depending upon the changing of these amino acid, we can change the nature of the protein. Then comes the secondary structure of protein. The secondary structure of protein is are the conformations, are the foldings of the linear polypeptide chains, which are the primary chains, which are the primary structure, into the specific arrangements which represents the secondary structure of the protein molecule. And this secondary structure of proteins, it refers to the shape in which the long amino acid chains exist, whether they are in a coil form and how the coiling takes place, how these are arranged to give some helical structure or to give some sheets like structure. So the secondary structure of proteins, these is further classified into two categories. One is the alpha helix, which is a helical structure, and one of them is the pleated sheets, which is basically the beta pleated structures. The helix is the right hand and is also called as the alpha helix, and the stability of these secondary structure of proteins is basically due to the presence of the hydrogen bonding between the amide hydrogen of the one peptide linkage and the amide carbonyl of the other peptide linkage. It means the peptide bond of the first linkage will make the hydrogen bonding with the some other peptide linkage within the molecule. So there is some intramolecular hydrogen bonding in the secondary structure, which stabilizes the secondary structure of the protein. So here, first of all, we will discuss about the alpha helix. The alpha helix model of protein was postulated by the Linus Pauling and the Robert Corey using the X-ray analysis of proteins in 1951. The peptide bond has a planar structure in the alpha helical structures, and all natural proteins, they bear the alpha helix, which is the most stable arrangement. It is predominant structure of the fibrous proteins such as myosin, which is a muscle protein, and of the alpha keratin, which is a hair protein, unstretched wools and nails proteins also. Here we have shown you the alpha helical structures, that how the primary structure of the protein is coiled in a helical form to give a alpha helix. This is the alpha helix, and here you can see that the COOH bond, this is the COOH bond of the first amino acid of the polypeptide chain. It forms a hydrogen bonding with the another one peptide bond within the molecule. So here the hydrogen bonding takes place between the carbonyl part of the one peptide linkage with the amide linkage of the other peptide bond. So here the hydrogen bonding takes place, which stabilizes this helical structure. In this alpha helix conformation, here again we have shown you the three dimensional structure of this helical structure of protein. In this conformation, the polypeptide chain, they assumes the form of a spiral. It means they are helically arranged to form a spiral like this, in a spiral staircase, which is having a difference of 3.6 amino acid residues per ton, and it is at a distance of 5.4 angstrom. It means the distance between these two turns is a 5.4 angstrom, and in these turns, 3.6, which is almost the 4 amino acids, the 4 amino acids are present in one ton. It means that the linkage will be in the first amino acid with the hydrogen bonding with the fourth amino acid. So it is a type of strong hydrogen bonding which prevents the free rotation, and so this helical is also rigid. And the diameter of this helix, this diameter is estimated to be 10 angstrom. So it was the alpha helical structure, and the main exception of this helical structure is that the proline amino acid cannot be fit into the alpha helix due to its ring structures, since proline is a 5-membered ring structure of amino acid. The other exceptions of this alpha helical structure is the valine and isoleucine, which also contains some bulky side chains which can break the helical structures. So the amino acid which do not fit into the helix are termed as the helix breakers. The alpha helix may either left or it may be right handed. So according to the theoretical calculations done by the Moffitt scientist, it was concluded that the right handed helix for the amino acid is more stable than the left-handed helix. Therefore, the right-handed helix is the one that would be expected to occur naturally. Then the next class of secondary structure of protein is the beta plated sheets or the beta conformations. Here the primary structure of protein has been arranged to form the sheets, and these sheets is a result of again the intermolecular hydrogen bonding, but here the bonding will takes place between the two different peptide chains, and these bonds are at the right angles to the main chains. In this arrangement, the each carboxyl oxygen on the one chain, it forms a hydrogen bond with the amide hydrogen on the adjacent chains. It means two polypeptide chains are there, so they make the hydrogen bonding. Two chains are making the hydrogen bonding within within that periphery. The beta plated sheets can run in the same direction, that is the parallel. Example of this class is the keratin, and they may run in the opposite direction, that is the antiparallel, as in case of fibrione. As the alkyl substituents on the alpha carbon of the amino acid on the adjacent chains are close to each other, we can have maximum hydrogen bonding interactions only when the substituents are small. When the amino acid which are having the R group small are present in the polypeptide chain, then the hydrogen bonding in this beta plated sheet will be strong. Examples of this class is the silk, which has a large segment of beta plated sheets because it has a large number of small amino acids. Beta carotene, keratin, which is found in feather and claw, is another example of this class of structures. Fibers containing the beta plated structures are not elastic because the polypeptide chains are fully extended. The number of side by side strands in the beta plated sheets, it may range from 2 to 15 in our globular proteins. It means there may be a arrangement in the parallel and the antiparallel structures that there may be 2 to 15 strands may be present in the beta plated sheets. The lysozymes and the several other enzymes, they have the regions of beta structure in addition to the extended chains and the alpha helical sections. The beta structure is of parallel types in lysozyme and antiparallel in the ribonuclease and the papain. Here we have shown you the beta plated structure of the secondary structure. We have shown the two peptide chains. These we have discussed that this only this part is the primary structure of protein. This again the primary structure, this again a primary structure of the polypeptide chains. Here the three polypeptide chains, they are making the hydrogen bondings within the chains. So these are the making the sheet like structure, as you have studied in case of graphite also, which is having the pleated structures. So if these two polypeptide chains, they run in a parallel directions, it means the arrangement of this peptide chain will be similar in both the chains. Here you can see that this CONH bond linkage is present in the first polypeptide chain here, and here also this is the first polypeptide chain, first peptide bond. Now the hydrogen bonding will take place between the carbonyl group of the peptide bond of first amino acid of the first polypeptide chain with the amide hydrogen of the second polypeptide chain. So hydrogen bonding will take place like this, making the parallel rearrangement of the beta plated sheet, and in the next in the next chain here you can see that they run in the antiparallel structures, that this CONH bond, they are trans to each other on this side, while here these are present on in a different arrangement, and again they are making the hydrogen bonds together to make a globular structure of the beta plated sheet. So this is the beta plated structure. Here again we have shown one more diagram for the secondary structure of protein. Here we have designated the C terminal and the N terminal of the polypeptide chain. This is the carboxylic acid end of the polypeptide chain, and this is the N terminal site, which is the amino side of the polypeptide chain. So since these two polypeptide chains, they run in a parallel direction, so hydrogen bonding will look like that it is somewhat not linear, while in case of the anti-parallel beta sheets, here the hydrogen bonding, it seems to be linear in case of the anti-parallel beta sheets. Now, a protein may or may not have the same secondary structure throughout the length. Some parts may be curled into the alpha helix, while the other parts are lined up into the pleated sheets. It may be because of helical breakers present in the polypeptide chain. If some leucine, isoleucine, valine and proline are present in the polypeptide chain, they may break the alpha helical structure and they may get coiled, or they may make some sheets into the form of secondary structures. So such the structureless part is called a random coil. The most globular proteins, they contains a segment of alpha helix or the beta pleated sheet separated by the links of random coils, allowing the molecule to fold into the globular shapes. Then comes the tertiary structure. This tertiary structure is the further more coiled structure of the secondary form, which is only because of the four types of different forces which are present in the tertiary structure of the protein, and these forces basically are the disulfide bond, the hydrogen bond, ionic bond and the hydrophobic bond which is present in the tertiary structure. So we will discuss about these bonds differently. First we will discuss about the hydrogen bond, which is present in the free amino groups and the free acetic group, which links the side chain so that a single peptide chain is held into a coil or a helical form. Then comes the ionic bond. Since the amino acid, they contains the sweeter ion structures, they have carbonate and the ammonium ions present inside the amino acids, so they make some ionic bonding within the molecule so that the structure get coiled to form the globular protein. Then comes the disulfide bond. Disulfide bond is basically present in those polypeptide chains which contains a cysteine and the methionine type of amino acid, which contains a sulfur element within the amino acid. So when this sulfur element is present within the molecule, they forms the sulfur-sulfur linkage, which is called the disulfide bond. Although these disulfide bridges are very strong when compared to the strength of the non-covalent bonds, these are very short range. Since as with the old covalent bonds, even a slight extension can break them completely. Then comes a hydrophobic bond, which is basically due to the presence of the bulky R groups, which are hydrophobic in nature. So the polypeptide chains which contains the tryptophan, phenylalanine, the bulky R groups are essentially the hydrophobic. They have very little attraction for the water molecule in comparison to the strong hydrogen bonding between the water molecules. The association of various R groups in this manner leads to a relatively strong bonding. Here we have shown you the tertiary structure of protein. This is the these are the alpha helical structures and these are the beta pleated sheets. When these are present within the same molecule, they make some globule like structure of the protein due to the presence of different type of bondings. Here we have shown you the type of bondings present in the structures, the interactions involved in the tertiary structure. This is the hydrophobic interaction and the van der Waal interaction, which is due to the presence of the R groups, which are the hydrophobic bulky groups, and this is the hydrogen bonding, which is present in this side chain, which contains the hydroxyl groups. And these are the disulfide bridges, which are basically due to the presence of the cysteine and the cysteine amino acid, which forms the disulfide bridges. And these are the ionic bonds, which are basically due to the acidic and the basic amino acid present within the molecule. So these are type of forces, they coils the secondary structure to make the tertiary structure. Then this tertiary structure further coils, further make subunits along with some other element to give the quaternary structure. Here you can see that this tertiary structure, this in the quaternary structure, this is only the one subunit which is in the tertiary form. So these tertiary structure, they further coils to give the quaternary structure, which is a regular association or two or more polypeptide chain to form a more complex structures. These involves a non-covalent association of two or more peptide chain in the protein molecule. And these also describes that these different chains and the components, how they interact and how they connect each other by the hydrophobic interactions, by the hydrogen bonding, by the electrostatic attraction and by the sulfide linkages and how they are arranged in the space. Example of this quaternary type of structure is a hemoglobin, which contains the four peptide chains fitted together to form a globular proteins. Here we have shown you the structure of quaternary proteins. These are the subunits which are the tertiary structure of proteins. Now, when these tertiary structures, they are present together along with the heme molecule, this is the heme, when they are chelated with the heme molecule, they get more complex to give the quaternary structure of the hemoglobin. One more class of quaternary structure of proteins is the enzymes. Lactic dehydrogenase is the example of this class, and the formation of multi enzyme complexes like FAD and NAD are also comes in the quaternary structure of proteins.
With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much, dear friends. We would be meeting again soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye.